So not necessarily the best state to be in. And it also makes difficult that moment when your customer says, so are you done? And you say, beats me. I don't know. When would you like it? We'll do as much work as we can to it and ship it. This was two companies that I'm working with in Boston area. Both are large, and they publish their products to a large number of customers externally. Both have about 800-900 developers. And they were having a very, very hard time getting everything done within an iteration. So they both came up with a scheme where they would have a sprint, a second sprint, and this is across all 800 developers. And then the third sprint would be the work needed to pull it all together, which would be called a stabilization sprint. And they'd have at the end of that something called a release candidate. And both of them, this only shows 9 months, but both were on 18-month release cycles. So they had 6 release candidates. And both of them, I was at both organizations when they got done with their last release candidate and entered into their probably 6 to 9 month stabilization phase, which provoked a seemingly innocent question of, what are you stabilizing? If you had release candidate, release candidate, release candidate, release candidate, there should be no stabilization. It turned out that release candidate, we put this as a quiz to the people there, what is a release candidate? And it turns out it's actually a point in time where you say, this is a release candidate. And everything demonstrated then was on a separate code branch for each team in the organization. So of course it was leaving behind profound amounts of undone work. One of the bugs that was recorded in the very second sprint is performance sucks. Well, that's a good one to leave until the 17th sprint after the architecture is way past remediation. But both of these situations, they didn't actually do it as done. And I still remember in one of the organizations, the general manager sitting there with his vice presidents of development, and they were looking very, very angry. And like, why are you angry? We have a question. Why is there a stabilization phase? And we said, brought out the burn downs, and the burn downs showed a very nice, smooth, linear decrease toward it all being done. And turned out they'd faked it. It was, if you're used to waterfall reports, no one reads them. So here's our Scrum report, so let's do this too. And the way their management had it interpreted is here's the new fad, it's called Scrum, was RUP, was waterfall, was whatever. We're gonna do everything the way we always did it, but now we have to report this way. And I was like, geez, 18 months, wow, what a waste, incredible. So even though we had long discussions about the definition of done, they didn't have time to do it. Interesting. This was Adobe Creative Suite. It's a smaller group, about 120 developers parsed out into 18 teams. And in the very first release, we were talking about the idea that if they really want to be done every sprint, the 18 teams would be integrating their work and doing integration testing, so integration builds and tests throughout the sprint, so they knew that they were done at the end of the sprint. And they said, geez, that's hard. We probably have to extend our build environment, integrate more of our testing environments, all those types of things. I said, like the one you're going to have to use at the end of the release. He said, that, we'd have to pull that back. So, okay. So he says, we don't have time to do that. And this is defects on the vertical axis time. In the first release, they started pulling it together about halfway, two-thirds of the way through the release, and found that there were an ever-increasing number of bugs. And the more they searched for bugs, the more they found bugs in kind of the state you don't want to get in. And they went past the planned release date, still a huge number of bugs, and they actually shipped the product. It was panned in the press. It was given negative reviews. People, customers left and right, did not upgrade to it under the advice of people. And a number of people were hospitalized from the stress of the huge work of trying to make the thing work. So the second time we tried something unique, which is we took the definition of done to include the integration of all those teams and integration testing, and we only selected as much work as we could do that too. And the teams started working together and put in the integration environment. And their defects never spiked because they were a predictable number of defects rising linearly. And they finished before the release date, went back and fixed some of this stuff, released a product that was very successful. Now, what's interesting about this is I'll talk to maybe a team of developers, and I'll say, so you selected three things. You didn't do any regression testing or performance testing. Why? I say, well, we didn't have time. So, well, what if you'd only selected one thing? Would you have had time? Because the amount of work is the same. You're going to do it sooner or later. But as the Adobe example points out, the amount of work that you're accumulating, it's called compound interest or something like that, accumulates so that you're increasing the amount of work by deferring it. Now, the only reason I'm saying that is these are like side consequences of the stupid definition of done. You know, who would have thought it would have such importance? I thought it was just needed for transparency, but it turns out it's needed so we save ourselves, our customers, and our people we ship to with our product. And of all things that I find any Scrum organization having trouble with, it's slowing down the amount of work that they select in a sprint so that it is totally done by the end of the sprint. One company I was working with, they said, well, we have like 100 things that we have to deliver. You know, it's in the list. And since we have 9 sprints, that means we have to do about 12 things per sprint. So what we're going to do is change our definition of done so we can do 12 things in a sprint. Something missed me on the logic of that. Because, of course, when they got done with the ninth month, they weren't done at all. They had this huge stabilization thing facing them. And if any issue that we have to wrestle with as organizations adopting Scrum, it is getting our developers to understand that quality software is going to have to be built one way or another. One way is a correct way, the other way is a very, very painful way. But there's no avoiding it. This was something I found also, side consequence. This perhaps may be something that happens to you at your greenfield company, and it's that you form a team of people to work on some software, and you've got a core product, an existing set of software that's been with the company 6-7 years, and your product backlog items are to enhance it, make some new changes to it, add some more persistence layer, things like that. And so you form your team, and in the past, you know, good team, maybe 12 product backlog items per sprint. But you find that when you form your team, you have two velocities going on. One of the velocities is around 16. Pretty good. That's when you're building the new parts of the user interface and setting up the new tables. But when you start going in and changing anything in the existing product, your velocity there is different. It tends to be around 2. And that makes it very hard to predict the speed of when you'll be done. We had one organization, DoubleClick, you know, the ad serving software, 20, 25 developers that knew the software pretty well, bought by a venture capitalist that really, really wanted to crank out more stuff so it'd get very visible and bought by eventually Google. And so they hired another 80 people. And they'd form Scrum teams, and every Scrum team would come to the end of the sprint and say, ha, here it is. Say, ah, okay, let's implement this. Oh, no, this is just the new stuff. We're going to tie it into the existing software later, meaning we couldn't do it. So we had this shelf full of new stuff that wasn't integrated into the existing software. So that would be our stabilization phase or something like that. So we formed a big room like this, all 100 and some people, chief product officer there, listed the product backlog here, and we formed team after team that had all the skills on it that could do the product backlog item, including integrating into the core product. We got 5 teams formed, had them leave the room, and we couldn't form any more teams. The other 70 people, we had nothing to do with. They didn't know how to build stuff in the core. So adding more people, even though if we were machines, would make us go faster, if you're working on a core product that's difficult and the people don't know it after years of work, you have what's called, by Goldratt, a constraint.